Jumpers. Weekdays, 5 to 8 p.m. Only on Massive Metro.
As usual, on Wednesday, we have guests which are authors. Already, we have an author right in front of me, and I'm holding his book in my hand. The name of the book, the title is Rights to Land. Very interesting. I can't wait to hear you unpack about this book. Welcome to the studio. We have Mr. Peter Delias.
Thanks very much for inviting me.
Yes, how are you, sir?
Very good, thank you.
Mm-hmm. I see your book, Rights to Land. I'm not sure if you're talking about planes when they are landing. Their rights.
No, I'm talking about terra firma. I'm talking about rights to ground.
Okay. What is this book all about?
Well, it's trying to grapple with some of the key issues which are confronting South Africa today. I think we now know, if we didn't know before, that land's a major unresolved issue in this society.
Yes.
It's been put back on the agenda with a vengeance. But when we started to write this book, it wasn't as yet such a hot issue. But it was still an issue which was difficult and troubling the society. So we looked at two areas: land restitution, which is the process of giving back land to those people who are dispossessed in the 20th century. And then we looked at the other process, which is rights to land, because part of what happens under apartheid and under racial domination is that the rights of black South Africans to land got diluted and diminished. In white areas, what you had a situation where private title, strong rights in land were created. But in black areas, where people previously had strong rights to land, where families had strong rights to land, their rights, in fact, got weakened and diluted and taken away from them, partly given to white officials, partly given to traditional leaders. So we were trying to come up with solutions to those. How do we go forward in relation to those issues?
I hear you saying we. I don't know who you're talking about.
Okay, so there's three authors in this book. There's William Baynard, who's a recently retired professor at Oxford University. And he and I know each other, have known each other since we were 16. And then there's, and we've both worked on land issues for our entire 40 years of our lives. And there's a very, very bright PhD student of mine called Dr. Michelle Hay, who did her PhD on issues of land rights and land restitution. So the three of us came together and pooled our skills and knowledge, and that's how this book came into existence.
But the issue of land has always been there. I'm actually a bit surprised if you say you guys were not aware that it's a big issue, the issue of land. The, all our songs almost talk about land. We, one of our biggest sayings is Izwele too, and Lizo Buya says that it's going to come back. It's always been there ever since we were born, the issue of land. Maybe on the other side of the fence, it wasn't attended, but it's always been a hot issue with
us. Of course, and that's I wasn't saying that wasn't the case. What I was saying is, in the political framework, we see land as a fundamental issue, and a fundamental issue to the past and the future of South Africa. We don't think it's ever not been a fundamental issue. All I was saying at the beginning is that very recently it's got a lot of political coverage that it hadn't in previous years. But you know, what we're saying is we're addressing a fundamental issue in the society. This is not something that we think has just become an issue. It's been an issue for hundreds of years.
So the black people and the black government want their land back. The majority of it, at least. We've had 20 years of preparing young people in terms of knowing about farming and engineering and and organic food and all of that. And those are also in the corridors of how to sell crops and how to empty the silos, I mean, when we fill them up. And so what is going to be the way forward that is not going to cause a further confrontation? Because you do know the story of Africa and land, where else there is native people and there is white people, and you know how it's always ended in every country. And how are we going to do it differently in Africa if people have been invited on the table for so long in South Africa to come and join us in the table, and people have refused to a point where now that chair is almost not there anymore. In the next 15 months or so, the issue of land is going to move from being a debate to becoming law after the elections. And a lot of things that people are thinking of now as suggestions may not exactly weigh, because the issue of land was promised to black people in the Freedom Charter, and now it's time.
Yeah. Look, I think there are a whole series of issues that we have to unpack to understand the land question. Mm-hmm. One of which is that the dispossession of black South Africans starts pretty much the moment that the first settlers arrive in South Africa in 1652, and it continues throughout. Mm-hmm. And there's no doubt that that process of dispossession of land played a fundamental part in impoverishing black South Africans.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an underlying reality that, that we have to confront.
Mm-hmm.
But there were also a whole number of other processes which impoverished black South Africans. The provision of poor quality education, if any, bad housing, job restriction, low wages.
Mm-hmm.
There's a whole complex of factors which produce a situation in this country where the majority of black people are poor, and where the fundamental issue that we face as a society is how to change the conditions of those people for the better.
Yeah.
And I think that's the promise of the post-apartheid era. Where I would disagree with you, or disagree with the assumption that you're making,
mm-hmm.
is that simply handing out land is going to do that. The evidence that we have so far is that processes of land redistribution and restitution have made very little difference in terms of the quality of life and the standard of living of ordinary black South Africans. If you were today in a place called Sekhukhuniland or Bopedi, where I do a lot of my research, if you're a young matriculant who's about to go out into the world, if you're a young person about to go out into the world, what would assist you more to make your way in the world effectively? Would it be a piece of land, or would it be a high-quality matric? So we have to decide as a society, it seems to me as a society, our priority is to deal with the terrible issue of poverty and stratification, differentiation in the society. But we need to do it in a way which uses the resources that we've got as a society most effectively to benefit the most people.
A lot of people work in the cities based on the fact that the land is simply for now not available. The land is full of rivers, it's got livestock, and it's got mineral underneath.
Mm.
So it goes back to the point that at the end of the day, everybody now thinks that the land is the solution. It's the land that will end poverty. It's the land that will bring high quality metric. It's the land that will bring high quality education, because we are fully aware of all the minerals that are being mined that the people are not benefiting from. And these contracts go as far back as the British colonial era. So the people are saying that we get the land first, we'll discuss it, the other things later, because I understand everything that you are suggesting. I'm from Soweto. I know exactly what you're talking about, the level of education and everything. Mm. But we also have our own discussions that we have in the side that will not allow anybody else to tip in and suggest or try to twist an argument. The issue of the land is that the land will bring the wealth, and the wealth will bring a good quality of life, will employ the parents will become landowners, and then the kids will get a better education.
Okay, see, the evidence doesn't support that. I mean, that may be your gut feeling. It may be other people's gut feeling, but the evidence does not suggest that under current conditions, handing out pieces of land to people,
that's a fraction of few people that may have failed. You cannot pin that on the entire black. In general,
what we see in South Africa is that small-scale farming operations are failing. White small-scale farming operations are failing. Black small-scale farming operations are failing. If you go out and talk to people, if you do scientific research amongst the majority of black South Africans, their number one priority is employment. Land, in fact, comes quite low down the list of people's priorities for what they think will matter. So the question you have to ask yourself is, what is most likely to produce jobs for people with decent wages and decent possibilities? Now, we have to deal with the issue of land reform, and we have to deal with the issue of the lack of legitimacy of our system of land rights in South Africa, which I think is a real problem. But we have to do it in a way which benefits the majority of the people. And I agree with the majority of people who say that their priority is jobs.
Baba,
and I think jobs will make the biggest difference.
Baba, I don't know how many people you've talked to, but where I come from, people don't want jobs anymore.
There are massive surveys across the country which make that point over and over again.
I don't know what reference, but people don't want jobs. People want to work for themselves, and hence the issue of the land. Because ever since I was born, and my mother and the people before them have been working for other races, that is the definition of a job. Because everybody who gets educated now goes to work in a big white corporate. So people no longer want that. The young people who are educated are talking innovative business. business now. The young people are going back to farming and they want their land. The state is trying its best to give the land. And you can't just point at a few researches that you've done and then say that
because of that, you can justify
the overall failure.
No, I mean, I think you're saying you know certain people. That's great. I know other people.
But wouldn't land create jobs for everyone?
No, it doesn't. Because, in fact, in order to make land productive, you've got to spend enormous amounts of money on it. So, in fact, in order to make land produce, you've got to have capital to make it produce. So if you don't come with the capital,
the state does
you
have
can't
that.
Produce it. Well, the state has money, but it has a huge variety of different priorities. Do we want a decent education system? Do we want decent health care for our people? Do we want
just
so these things are not, there's not simply an unending pot of money. We have to make choices. We also have to deal with people's own perspectives and aspirations. And what I say to you is that mass-based survey research, which is pretty accurate at predicting trends in the society, do not agree with what you're saying.
I think we need a second opinion on that, because you are telling us of your research and
people. I'm talking about national research.
But I could bring in other people who've done the research who say that black people are actually succeeding in farming.
No, but these are different questions.
It could be a point of...
These are different questions. You're conflating two different things. One point that I'm making is that surveys of black opinion in the society show that the main priority is jobs. Are there some people who are succeeding on the farm? Yes, there are. Should be they supported? Yes, they are. Are there a significant amount? No, they're not at the moment.
But I'm telling you, sir, that the reason why people are saying jobs is because they were indoctrinated to think like that. Because they
don't
know. Yes, sir, it's been 400 years of indoctrination.
No. Migrant workers are stupid.
Baba, the reason why people came to Jersey. No.
I don't believe.
Baba, a nation can be indoctrinated. The reason why people come to Jersey to look for a job. May I speak, please?
No, I don't believe. Well, I mean, I just simply. You're discounting everything I say. You're saying that I have no evidence. I mean, why are we having this discussion?
No, sir, we're having a debate.
Oh, is that what it is?
Yes, sir. I'm saying that people have been coming to Joburg because of the gold, since the days of the gold rush, because they had no choice, because the land was taken away from them. Migrant workers as far as Zimbabwe. Now people are saying that they want the land back, because first they want to go home, they want to go back to their ancestral land, but now they know what is under the land, which of course with proper mining, which if majority of that money goes to black people, that the metric you're talking about, which is the argument of low education, the good family life structure, the fathers getting proper money to educate their kids, all of that will come from the money. So I don't necessarily agree with the fact that you say that people say they want jobs.
I don't agree with your model. I don't agree with your account of what people think. And we can sit here. I think your account is completely wrong. You think my account is completely wrong. It's a futile exchange. If you're not prepared to recognize that I have done research, which is significant, let us suggest that in order to resolve this problem, because you and me shouting at each other, it's not going to help. And you telling me that I don't know what's going on, it's not going to help particularly. It may make you feel good, but it's not a particularly constructive way to move forward on the land issue. I would suggest that your radio station, which is very clearly close to the heart of the people, has the pulse of the people, that you run a survey on black opinion, on what people want, what their priorities are.
If you fund us, we'll be more than happy, sir.
And then if you... what can I fund you? I sit here with a few pennies and a water bottle. But I'm sure you've got donors who can help you do that. Do that. Then when you've done that research, because you say my research is not worth it, when you've done that research, when you can say to me something beyond that, I and my friends are ecstasy, when you've done that, I suggest... call me back onto the program, and you can tell me what an idiot I am, and that all the research that I've quoted is rubbish. But at the moment, you are simply disputing on the basis of no research other than a few people you've chatted to in your circle.
I'm sorry, sir. My entire life is research. I lived in KZN and I was born in that concentration camp called Soweto.
So
my entire life is research.
Well, there you are. So you have a very particular lifetime perspective. I have a very particular lifetime perspective. I don't begin to imagine that I have complete understanding of the trajectories of people's aspirations and opinions in the society. I wouldn't be as arrogant as to suggest that. I certainly wouldn't begin to suggest that all black people think X or Y. My experience of black people, but is that they're very diverse. They have different opinions and attitudes. They don't all think like a mob or think like a herd. I think they're smart as well. So I think the idea that people are suckered, they're tricked, they fooled into thinking that they really want jobs, is quite frankly insulting to the majority of black South Africans.
Only on Massive Metro.